Of prayer, so could somebody please start off this session with prayer? Yeah, Charles, would you like to pray? Can't hear you, Charles. There's an audio issue. Charles is not able to pray. Could somebody else lead, please? Prabhakar, how about you?
I can pray, Pastor.
Oh, okay, sure. Rose, please go ahead.
Okay. Father in heaven, all glory, praise, and honor to you. Thank you for another space and time when we can learn more about you. Help us settle in this moment so we may receive what you have willed to reveal to us. We commit this hour to you, Father. Open our eyes, open our ears, most of all, open our hearts and make them fertile soil so your word might produce fruit, some 30, some 60, and some even 100-fold. In the name of your only Son, Jesus Christ, and the help of your most Holy Spirit, amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Rose, for leading us in prayer. So we will just have a very quick review of what we have learned in the last class. We talked about kingdom thinking, and we said that the way we think as people of the kingdom is different from the way the world thinks. So based on our thinking, obviously our thinking is going to translate into the decisions that we make. It's going to translate into the lifestyle that we develop. So kingdom thinking will produce kingdom lifestyle. And as part of the kingdom, we saw that we are in the kingdom of light. So, you know, these are all ways of living righteous. These are all patterns where we are called to exercise kingdom authority. These are all decisions that we make with kingdom resolve for the sake of the kingdom. So though we live here on the earth, we know the way Jesus said, I am from above. We are people from above with that born again life of Christ. So we're living the regular life like everyone else, but we have a kingdom mindset and we have a kingdom way of thinking. So we looked at different thinking patterns, decisions that we can incorporate. We said as part of the kingdom, we have higher living standards. Jesus went a step further from just the behavior aspects to the motives and the intentions of an individual. We talked about having faith in everything that we do. We talked about living this life for the sake of the King, because we are part of the kingdom of God. We said that we need to have a mindset which is childlike, as in depending on God, relying on God, and completely pledging our allegiance to God. Then we talked about servant humility, where we learn that those who are least in the kingdom, right? Those who humble themselves in the kingdom, they are the greatest. We talked about celebrating the King's perspective, where we know that our King is righteous and he is just. So the decisions that he makes, we put our trust in that. Okay, and we are led by the King. We are directed by the King. Kingdom resolve, we talked about committing ourselves, you know, letting, though we're living here in the world, we are responsible for all that God has entrusted to us. But at the same time, we are very focused on the expansion of the kingdom, on the fruitfulness of the kingdom life that God has given us. So the focus is always there and it must remain. We also talked about the fact that when we live for the kingdom, there will be rejection, which we might experience from time to time, but we don't let that affect us. We take it knowing that, you know, God is the one who ultimately rewards us for being faithful to him. So that even persecution, opposition for doing the right thing. Now, obviously, we're not encouraging doing the wrong thing and then receiving opposition for it. So when we're doing the right thing, living for God, we are bound to experience rejection, but we face it positively, knowing the eternal rewards. And then The next section here talks about trusting God over the riches of this world. And, you know, this is this cannot be overemphasized. Jesus brought it up in his teachings. We see this in other passages of the New Testament where we are encouraged not to, you know, I mean, obviously, again, we are living in the world, so we have to be earthly wise. But giving ourselves completely to the world, or the world having us, you know, the lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh, and the pride of life, when those things take over, our kingdom focus, our kingdom resolve can diminish. So we have to be careful about not giving into the things of the world. Then last section, I think, says we live righteously, and we live so not for the sake of our reputation, but it's an inner transformation. See, the Christian life is always lived inside out. So we're not doing anything to earn God's approval. We are not doing anything to earn our salvation. Salvation is already given to us as a gift of God's love. But once we receive that, we live a righteous life, living out of the truth that exists, which is we are now the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus, as 2 Corinthians 5:21 puts it. So we live our lives inside out and not outside in. So the example of people who live their lives for the sake of man's applause, they are the Pharisees. Okay, in scripture. So you find Jesus rebuking them and telling them, hey, you know, you're not doing this for the glory of God, but it's just an outward form, or it's a shell, or it's projecting something to the world which actually does not exist. So that is not kingdom thinking, and that is not kingdom living. But kingdom living, true kingdom living, has to be from the inside out. So these are the patterns that we are called to. When we look at the word of God, we know that we are complete, we are born again, and our spirit is transformed 100%. And the life of God is flowing in and through our spirit man. But given that, you know, we also have a mind, okay? And the mind, which has the components of our will, our emotions, and what's the third one I'm forgetting? Mind, will, and our emotions, okay, our decision making. So the mind has to be renewed, and the mind can be renewed as we meditate on the word of God. And as the book of Proverbs 4, you know, it says that you take the word and keep it in the midst of your heart, keep it in the center of your heart. So when the word is inside us, the word will transform us. Okay, and also the psalmist writes, right, like, how can a young man keep his way pure? By hiding the word of God in his heart. So the word of God in our lives will bring the transformation. Now, as we study about kingdom thinking, as we study about kingdom living, some of us could feel that I'm far from this pattern of thinking, or, you know, I'm far from making decisions in this sort of a righteous way. But see, the whole point is, yes, by virtue of our exposure, by virtue of our upbringing, our background, so maybe we are not used to some patterns of kingdom thinking. But the good news is that we're all called to renew our minds, right? So it's only when we renew our minds, as we commit our bodies as a living sacrifice to God, that whatever we are taking in from the word of God, you know, that begins to transform our lives. And so we start living it out. It's more than just saying, oh, wow, you know, thinking in this way is good, and I must decide in accordance to this word of God. But it becomes a part of you. And even through the leading and the prompting of the Holy Spirit, we can make decisions based on these kingdom principles that we looked at. So today we will jump into the next chapter here, which is about kingdom living. So the kingdom thinking, kingdom pattern of kingdom mindset should translate into the lifestyle that you and I develop. So going into this chapter here on kingdom living, we begin with an introduction where Jesus used to preach and say that the kingdom of God is within you. Okay, so the kingdom of God, you know, again, the kingdom of God is what God has done in us, and we continually release that life of God. So the kingdom of God within us is you know, the Holy Spirit working in us, the transformation that has come through us becoming born again, and you know, through the word of God, whatever is being deposited into our spirit, basically the rule, the reign, the domain of the king within us, okay, and every aspect of our lives. So when Jesus preached the kingdom, the Pharisees expected him to talk about a literal kingdom. They expected him to talk about establishing Jerusalem as the headquarters. They expected him to talk about the conquest of new territories in a literal geographical sense. But they must have been amazed to hear the teaching of Christ, where Jesus said that the kingdom of God is near you, the kingdom of God is within you. So he was preaching and saying that the kingdom of heaven, the rule and reign of the kingdom of heaven, can be experienced by everyone who believes right here on earth. So he used terms to describe the nearness of the kingdom, even the fact that the kingdom of God is within us. So the kingdom of God, again, has to be an outworking. So it is within us. And every day as we abide in the Lord, John chapter 15, it says that we must abide in the Lord. And if you study the book of 1 John, you know, it talks about the fellowship that we have with the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. So we begin to live our lives fellowshipping with God, and there are many ways in which we do that. You know, we pray, we worship, we spend time in the Word, we meditate the Word, we live a life of obedience to God. And as we are doing all these things, we can expect the very life of God, the very kingdom of God to flow out of us. And that's the manner in which the outworking of the kingdom actually takes place. So this is a good thought. Right? So to the extent that the kingdom rules within me, the kingdom will rule around me and through my ministry or through my life. Okay, so we let the kingdom reign in us. That is what is most important. So when the kingdom reigns within me, I'm able to release that kingdom in various ways. And I can touch the lives of people. I can bless the lives of people. So the kingdom from within, the kingdom which is near, the very kingdom of heaven, the rule and reign of God, it's not limited just to heaven, but by way of me abiding in God, by way of my intimacy with God, you know, that release is given to me, and that rule and reign from within me is released outside to the world. So while the Pharisees expected a kingdom outside of them and a literal kingdom that they could feel and touch, the kind of kingdom that Jesus was talking about was very different. It was a spiritual kingdom, but a kingdom which could affect the natural world. Okay, so what are the characteristics of this kingdom? Now, the characteristics of this kingdom will be the values that kingdom people carry. And every believer is a kingdom person. So every believer should have and carry these values. Okay. Yes, thank you, Samuel and Mangi, for answering Christopher's question here. So we're in chapter 5. And right now, page number 27. So we're looking at the characteristics of kingdom living. So the first characteristic of kingdom living is holiness and reverence. Okay, holiness and reverence. So this needs to be a part of all of our lifestyle. Now, looking at the Corinthian church, you know, Paul addresses the Corinthian church and he invites them to have a life which is aligned to what God has already done for them. So it'll be helpful to read the passage which is given here on page 27. If somebody could read 2 Corinthians 6, verses 14 through 18. That will be good. Could somebody please read it?
Shall I read, ma'am?
Yes, yes, please, Amni. Go ahead. Thank you.
2 Corinthians 6, 14 to 18. Do not be unequally yoked together with unbelievers, for what fellowship has righteousness with lawlessness? And what communion has light with darkness? And what accord has Christ with Belial? Or what part has a believer with an unbeliever? And what agreement has the temple of God with idols? For you are the temple of the living God. As God has said, I will dwell in them and walk among them. I will be their God, and they shall be my people. Therefore, come out from among them and be separate, says the Lord. Do not touch what is unclean, and I will receive you. I will be a father to you, and you shall be my sons and daughters, says the Lord Almighty. Amen.
Yes, thank you, Amni. So here we find that Paul is inviting the Corinthians who lived, very sinful lives, just by the things that he is sharing here. And then as you go through the book of Corinthians, you will find that they carried and they brought all kinds of issues that they had earlier into the church. So Paul had to address matters of unity. He said, okay, you must not live in strife and division. There is sexual immorality among you, and just issues of life that were not pertaining to the kingdom of light. Okay, so even here, he's telling them and he's saying that you must live a life which is separate unto God. And God is saying, when you do that, when you live a life when you have separated yourself unto God, you know, I will be your father. So this aspect of holiness, as you look at the Old Testament, we find that there were certain vessels, there was some furniture, there were things which were set aside, or there were people who were set aside for the service of God. And anything which was set aside for the service of God, generally we see that God told the priests, you know, that it must not be mixed with anything else. It must be separated unto the Lord. Or in other words, it must be kept holy. So the meaning of holy is keeping aside, setting it aside, or dedicating it. The general example which I use, and a lot I've heard others use also, is, you know, the communion cups that we use in church. Generally, the communion cups are treated with a lot of reverence. Okay, so you clean them up and you keep it for whichever Sunday where your church practices Holy Communion. So on that Sunday, it's brought out neatly set, and the grape juice is poured into that and distributed. And once that's done, again, it's taken and put back. But nobody will ever think of using the communion cup for anything else, because, you know, it's almost like, whoa, we could never do that. You can't touch that holy thing and maybe, you know, use it for some other beverage. Because it's set aside and it is kept aside for God. So holiness is like that. You know, our lives are set aside for God. And Paul is telling the Corinthians, once they were born again, he's saying, look, what is the connection of light with darkness? What is the connection of righteousness with lawlessness? Right? So what is the connection of God with Satan? Now, we know that there is a huge divide. There's no way of these two things connecting together, because if there is light, there is no darkness. Okay. So what is Paul actually saying? He's saying that we must live a life which is clearly holy, okay? A life which is set aside for God. So when it comes to the decisions we make, when it comes to the way we choose to live, we make every effort to live it in such a way that there is God's truth in our lives, and that nothing puts us away from the worship of God. Right? If anything at all should not make me mix with the things things of the world. So basically sinful things, basically standards which don't glorify God. Paul is inviting the believer in every aspect of their lives to live holy. So whether it is our workplace, and I'm sure, you know, in the workplace, there are so many opportunities for us to make the wrong decisions, because the world out there wants to be profitable in any which way, hook or crook. But that's not how a believer must demonstrate prosperity. Similarly, you know, when it comes to relationships, when it comes to even ministry, we can do it whichever way we want, but we have to go by the standards of God. We have to go by the right things and the truth of God's word. Paul is saying that there's no connection of darkness with light. So we are called to holiness and to reverence. Now, Paul also points out, you know, to the Corinthian church as well as other churches, he calls out certain things in people's lifestyle. Okay, and now we might want to think that, oh, these are extreme sins, or you know, things like this I'm not associated with, and so, you know, I don't relate to this. So whatever, even if you don't relate to it, Paul did see sins like this and he called it out. So he was addressing certain Christians whose sins were out there. Okay, he addressed it harshly and he warned them. So in 1 Corinthians 6 verses 9 through 10, he calls out things like fornication, idolatry, adultery, homosexuality, and you know, he says now sodomites, thieves, those who are covetous, drunkards, revilers, extortioners. He goes to the extent of saying that, you know, such people will not inherit the kingdom of God. So, you know, developing that sinful lifestyle, not responding to the convictions of the Holy Spirit. And when people are caught up in these kind of sins, you know, Paul brings them a very stern warning and says that you run the risk of losing the kingdom of God even. Okay, there are other such sins that he writes about. He writes to the Galatians. He says lewdness, uncleanness, contentions, hatred, sorcery, jealousy, outbursts of wrath, selfish ambition, dissensions, heresies. Right. So he basically lists out all these patterns of life, and he says that it doesn't suit a person who has experienced salvation. Salvation is about sanctification, right? We have been saved, we have been cleansed, and in Christ Jesus, we have already been sanctified. But the beauty of God's word is that it also says that we are being sanctified. Okay? So it is a continuous process as well, which is taking place in our lives, and we must yield to that. So when we talk about kingdom living, one aspect that we must have as a characteristic or a value in us is holiness and reverence, because outside of that, you know, we are not really demonstrating the true nature of the kingdom of God. Okay, and God gives us the grace to live with holiness, and we've talked about this several times, where we've said that God has already empowered us. He has given us the victory. We have the covenant blessings of the cross. Sin shall not have dominion over us. So whatever we need to live a victorious life has already been handed to us. Now the decision is ours. We need to walk faithfully before God and live that life of holiness. So I see a question here from Christopher, and he's saying, please define yoked with examples. Can a believer be unequally yoked with an unbeliever? Okay, so Christopher, this passage is usually used to talk about you know, a believer wanting to marry an unbeliever. So then, you know, people say, don't be unequally yoked. Right? What does light have to do with darkness? So yes, that is the right application also. But even in general, Paul is writing this to the believers, I think applying not specifically to marriage alone, but it is applying to any sort of close decision making kind of connections that we have. Okay, so I would also say okay, so suppose you have a ministry, okay, or let's say a kingdom venture that you are launching out, and the values, the core values of that venture are based on scripture, okay, and you are the founder of this venture, and you're going ahead and starting it out. Now, the kind of people that you must have as your close advisors or partners, ideally, it should be those who have your values, because the mission and the vision of what you are doing is kingdom based. Now, if you have, let's say, an unbeliever, sooner or later, you might run into conflict of interest, because you might find that, you know, they don't agree with the way you want to handle money, or with the way you want to, approve certain things that you've come across. So basically, decision making, value based decision making, right? So unequally yoked would mean that when you are in a close relationship, even a working relationship with somebody, where both of you have to make big decisions, right? So if we are unequally yoked, and for something like a kingdom venture, then you will run into difficulty when it comes to decision making. And appropriately, talking about a believer marrying an unbeliever, we know that, you know, that's not it's not advisable, and the word of God definitely does not recommend that, because the value system is different. And here there is a spiritual dimension to marriage. Okay, so if one person is born again, you know, it's like they are from the kingdom of light, and one person is not born again, they are from the kingdom of darkness. Now, how do two people, like the book of Amos 3, it says, how can two people walk together if they do not agree, right? Sooner or later, you're going to end up with a lot of challenges because of the decisions that you have to make. Okay, and I would anyway, that's a different dialogue. I'm going on a tangent. So does it make sense, Christopher?
Yes, I think I also asked a question, because a few years ago when I started a commercial venture business, I was advised that, you know, if I was to look for a business partner, it should be a believer. And I could not find anyone, so finally I decided to do it all by myself. So that was something that I and that's what really prompted me to ask that question.
Yes.
The second question is, I see about, you know, just about you know, because there it is mentioned unequally yoked. So I was just saying, are there any scenarios where you could be equally yoked with an unbeliever? But I don't think that's really going to be possible, right?
No. There's no question, no, Christopher, because the values are so different.
Right, yeah. Thank you.
Sure, no problem. And just an extension to what we are discussing here. Now, this doesn't mean that we cannot have a working relationship with an unbeliever. That's not the point. No, we invariably, when we get job assignments, we are working with unbelievers, and that's okay, that's totally fine. Now, we're talking about positions where we have to make decisions together with them, right? Kingdom decisions. Now, if there is going to be interference when you're launching out a business, in that scenario, in that context, being unequally yoked can cost us. But otherwise, yes, you know, if you have, even though you have a kingdom venture, if you have people at a level of implementation where they're just very skilled and they're able to roll out what you have planned or designed, that's fine, because you know they're at a different level. They're not at the decision-making level, right? So when it comes to a decision-making level, where you have to make big decisions about the resources, about the future plans, if we are unequally yoked, that is very difficult. So just a little clarity there. Yes. Any other thoughts or questions about a lifestyle of holiness and reverence? We could address that and then move forward. Okay, so I think it's rather clear. We are called to live a life which is holy, set apart for God, committed to God. Okay, moving forward. A life which has the rule and reign of the kingdom of God will also have righteousness, peace, and joy, because that is what you have up in heaven, and that's what God wants for us here on earth. So this passage from Romans 14, verse 16 through 19, it says, the kingdom of God is not eating and drinking, but righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit. And we have to live a life in this manner, acceptable to God and approved by men. So now, how do we do this? How do we live a life of righteousness, peace, and joy? Well, it would be a life of surrender to God. Basically, that's what it means. Now, when we are walking obedient, when we are yielding to God at every prompting of the Word, every prompting of the Holy Spirit, righteousness, it not just in the positional truth, but also in our walk, you know, we are able to live out that righteous life. Peace. When we are at peace with God, that peace will flow through in our daily lives. And joy. Of course, we don't have anything hindering our relationship with God. We're abiding in God. Then the joy of God also begins to flow out of us. And also notice in the passage, he says that the kingdom of God is not about eating and drinking, but righteousness, peace, and joy. So basically, he's also making a point there where he says that as we live out the life here on earth, you know, we are actually rejoicing about the things of the kingdom. So when it comes to the benefits or the privileges that this world has to offer, even if it comes to letting go of our rights sometimes, okay, we are willing to do that. So instead of, you know, suppose you are not well accepted for your faith, and your friends say that, okay, we are not going to invite you for a particular gathering, you're okay, because for the sake of the kingdom, you're letting go those friendships or those relationships or certain things that you could have had if you compromised your lifestyle. But you're not willing to compromise, and therefore you are experiencing the righteousness, peace, and joy of the kingdom instead, right? And that should be enough, and we are given to that. So that's what we are called to, and God will release that for us, and we can walk in it. So righteousness, peace, and joy. And now we also realize that, you know, it's a wonderful thing. In our everyday lives, we may be going through circumstances where that peace and joy, because of the circumstances, it may not come naturally. But because we are people of the kingdom, and the way Jesus taught, he said, the kingdom is in you. Right? So the righteousness, peace, and joy can actually be produced inside and be released outside. So that's the beauty of it. So inside out, righteousness, peace, and joy. We can bring the kingdom. Jesus taught us to pray, thy kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven. And we can see the release of that kingdom. Okay, I see that Sri Kumar has a follow-up question to what we were talking about. So just backtrack a little bit. I hope that doesn't confuse us. So in the context of working with an unbeliever, Sri Kumar is asking, taking advice from an unbeliever consultant, is the right thing. Okay. So, Shrikumar, the point is, what kind of advice? Okay, it depends on that.
Is it business advice taking from the an unbeliever consultant? Is it okay? Is it right? Because anyway, yeah. For health, anyway, we can consult with a doctor.
Hmm.
That's another thing.
Mm-hmm.
But consulting about the business, is it the right thing what we do? Or I just want to know that. Thank you.
Okay, sure. Yes, thank you. Yeah, that's something we do think about. I believe that it's okay, because see, when you are going to a consultant, you're going on the basis of their work experience. You're going for an opinion based on their skill.
Yes.
So yeah, there's nothing wrong with that. I mean, if they have those many years of experience in the workplace, you can take their advice. But when it comes to implementing it, I think the only thing we should be careful about is check whether some of the principles that they have shared, are they based on the kingdom? If it's not, then don't implement it. That's all.
Thank you, Pastor. Thanks a lot.
Yeah,
thank you.
Sure. Thank you. The converse of this is, unfortunately, like if you don't have a believer who is skilled, or you don't have a believer who is well experienced in that area of work, then you know you have to go to an unbeliever. It doesn't give you much of an option, right?
Yeah, very true.
Yeah. So I think we can like encourage young people to pursue their dreams, their careers, and everything. We should have a lot of skilled believers, hopefully.
Yes, true. Yes, Pastor. Thank
you. Yeah. Right. Thank you. Okay. All right. So now we will continue. We talked about righteousness, peace, and joy that is produced within us, and it's something that the Holy Spirit produces in us. So, you know, we can actually walk victorious in the midst of storms. Okay. The next characteristic is power, authority, and dominion. Yes. Power, dominion, and authority. Now, Paul, when he wrote to the Corinthian believers, he said the kingdom of God is not in word but in power. So the kingdom, we talk about the kingdom and we connect demonstration of the kingdom, because if we fail the demonstration of the kingdom, then just talking about it is actually incomplete. Okay, and that's the way Paul introduced the kingdom. Even Jesus, preaching, teaching, and demonstrating. We've seen this earlier when we talked about the kingdom of God. So, demonstrating the power, the authority, and the dominion of the kingdom becomes very, very important for a believer. So, instead of being bogged down by all that the world brings at us. We've talked about this in the believer's authority as well, right? So the world comes against us, or it could be Satan who plots against us, whatever it is, any sort of an interference, anything that is against the purpose of God, we can override it by the dominion that the Lord Jesus has bought back for us on the cross of Calvary. So we can silence every storm, and we can walk on the water, so to speak, right? So as a kingdom person, we must be demonstrating power, authority, and dominion. So that is something we can ask ourselves. You know, how is it going in terms of my personal life? You know, how is it going in terms of the way I deal with problems, situations? It could also be like sickness or some oppression that we might be going through. Now, am I really using what God has put on the inside of me? So if I'm a kingdom person, yes, I'm facing all these situations, but I have the authority. So we release the power of the kingdom into those circumstances. How do we do it? Various ways. You know, we could decree, declare. We've talked about prayer, the way when we pray, we are releasing the kingdom of God. So for a kingdom person, you know, it's not just about living right. Use biblical principles, use kingdom principles, live right, live righteous, live holy. And that's about it. Yes, that's important. But in addition to that, you know, we are a part of a kingdom dynamic where there is power and authority. We're already victorious, so we are fighting a defeated foe, but we can we can demonstrate that victory, okay, over Satan and the world. And that should be something that is happening in our everyday lives. And similarly, when it comes to ministry, preaching, yes, there is a place for preaching, there is a place for teaching, but the demonstration of the power of God. So as we proclaim the word, it's always a blessing when we hear things like, okay, you shared that, or there was this prophetic word and I got healed, this miracle happened. Because what is that? It's from the kingdom. It's the power of the kingdom which is being released into an individual's life. And as kingdom people, that should be normal for us to receive those confirmations of the living kingdom in our midst. So power, authority, and dominion is also a lifestyle that we must carry. Now, moving to the next focus here, it's endurance and suffering. Endurance and suffering, you know, by way of us living here on the earth, we know that we would go through trials, tribulations. These are things that Jesus said we will definitely face. But also because we are kingdom people and we're making kingdom decisions, there will be opposition. There could be persecution. And in the midst of these things, we have to demonstrate endurance. And that also is something which must be seen in the lifestyle of a kingdom person. And the way we face persecution is also very, very, how do I put it? You know, that is also a testimony, isn't it? So we face it knowing that we are doing the right thing, and we have eternal rewards for the opposition which is coming against us. So endurance and suffering in the midst of these things that we go through here on the earth, that also shows the kingdom lifestyle. Extending forgiveness. Okay, extending forgiveness is walking in obedience, right, to what God expects of us. So over here in this section, the passage which has been listed is the one where a master, he forgives a servant, and that servant is supposed to forgive another person, right, who owes him some talents. But you notice that the servant is unwilling to forgive another person who owes him. So the master rebukes him and he says, you know, what is this? Like, I gave you a forgiveness, but you're not willing to extend it to others. So God's expectation is that you and I will continue to walk in that forgiveness which he has given us. So we demonstrate it, and we glorify God, right, in the kind of lifestyle that we have. So as part of this same passage which has been given here, in that parable, you also notice that the master gives some talents to the servant, right? And this servant is to this servant is expected to invest those talents and be fruitful. Okay, however, he doesn't do it. So the master rebukes him this as well. And he says that, you know, if you would have given me the money, I would have invested it and I would have got some benefit out of it. So there's also the aspect of stewardship, which this particular passage is talking about. So I thought I would highlight that as well. So in the kingdom of God, we're talking about living with the right values, living a lifestyle of holiness, living to demonstrate the kingdom, the power of God, living to release the righteousness, peace, and joy of God. But in addition to that, you know, having the capacity to endure, having the capacity to suffer for the sake of righteousness, extend forgiveness, and also be good stewards and be fruitful in whatever has been entrusted to us. So these are some aspects that we are touching upon today, but this is not to say that, you know, an exhaustive list has been presented to us. So some of the main things which describe our lifestyle have been given here in this particular chapter. But, you know, if you have any thoughts, you two could share it and we can discuss on those particular characteristics that a believer must have. So at this point, I think I'm just going to pause. If you have any comments for what has been talked about so far, we can take that up. You want to say something? Okay, the audio is not coming through. It seems like a problem there. Okay, you could type your question, say. Anyone else? Any thoughts? All right. So if we don't have any inputs for now, we can take a break and we'll come back in 10 minutes and continue from where we've stopped. See you all in 10 minutes. Thank you.